Welcome back! My name is Ballerscuba. This is Video Games Over Time! We are still in 1985. Today, we're going to talk about baseball. Baseball poses a large learning curve to anyone who did not grow up with the game. The game has its own terminology, a storied history, and a complicated set of rules that are not always apparent to anyone unfamiliar with the game. It's understandably a topic that many video game fans avoid. However, baseball often plays an integral role in the history of video games, so it is worthwhile to look into the sport to gain at least a basic understanding of how it works. We will start with the history of baseball. The origins of baseball are one that are a matter of contention. While the game most certainly is derived from folk games in Europe, it is nearly impossible to say with any certainty when the game started to separate from the other forms of bat and ball games and became its own sport. This has been hotly debated for over a century, with some saying the game derives from the English game of rounders, while others say it is based on an American game named Old Cat. For a long time, it was accepted that a U.S. Army officer named Abner Doubleday invented the game in Cooperstown, New York in 1839, but this has been discredited. Regardless of the game's first origins, the game had conclusively started in some sense by 1845, when New York City's Knickerbocker Club created a set of rules for the game, known as the Knickerbocker Rules. While games played under Knickerbocker rules would still look quite different to a modern baseball fan, it is often said that the modern game evolved from these rules. Baseball became popular in the New York metropolitan area in the 1850s. It was then that journalists began calling the game the national pastime or the national game. By 1857, the first organization for American baseball was formed, named the National Association of Baseball Players, or NABBP. This association of 16 clubs created their own set of rules for the game, modifying the Knickerbocker rules. Baseball would lose popularity during the American Civil War, but would rebound quickly after the war was over. It is said that baseball was the nation's most popular sport in the 19th century. The first surviving major league was founded in 1876, the National League. The National League was not alone, with several other leagues forming and closing around it, including so-called Negro Leagues, which were almost always the only leagues that would allow African American players. The leagues would continue to tweak the rules of the game through 1901, when the last major change to the rules would be implemented. Since 1901, the major rules of the game have largely stayed the same, and a modern baseball fan would be able to recognize the game being played on the field. Also in 1901, the American League was formed, the first successful counterpart to the National League. By this point, both leagues each had 8 teams. They would often get into disputes regarding the best players in the country, and would often engage in legal proceedings. This would lead to the National Agreement of 1903. This agreement formalized relations between the two major leagues, and also how the two major leagues would interact with many of the nation's minor leagues, which were not as popular, and where the players were not necessarily as good. The two leagues combined would establish the name Major League Baseball, or MLB. This agreement would also lead to the first World Series, a series of championship games between the champions of the American League and the champions of the National League to determine the best baseball team overall. Outside of a boycott from one of the teams in 1904, the World Series would become an annual tradition from that point forward. In the 1919 World Series, there was a scandal, known as the Black Sox scandal. Several players, upset at their owner for pay issues, conspired to intentionally lose the World Series. In response, the Office of the Commissioner of Baseball was established in 1920, with Kennesaw Mountain Landis elected as the first commissioner. This was to help restore the integrity of the game and to help ease relations between the team's owners and the players. The Negro National League, the first significant Negro league, was also founded in 1920. While the American and National Leagues did not have formal rules barring African American players, the owners of the teams had an informal agreement to not allow African Americans onto their teams. So the Negro National League became the only place for African American players. In 1922, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled on the case Federal Baseball Club versus National League, which established that Major League Baseball's activities were not considered interstate commerce, so would not be subject to federal antitrust laws. Since then, Major League Baseball has enjoyed nearly unquestioned authority over professional baseball in America. This has led to long-standing traditions and resistance to change in the game of baseball. In the 1920s, several rules and stadiums were tweaked. These tweaks made the game more advantageous to the hitters or the team's offense. This would result in more home runs and higher scoring games. As a result, baseball between 1900 and 1920 is said to have been in the dead ball era. Baseball after 1920 is said to be in the live ball era. The best example of this would be the legendary player Babe Ruth. Babe Ruth was the first great power hitter in baseball, hitting far more home runs than anyone had before. Before Babe Ruth, the all-time career home run record stood at 138. Babe Ruth hit 714 in his career. This not only made Babe Ruth a legend, both in America and overseas, but also gave the team where he played most of his years, the New York Yankees, the reputation for being the best in the sport. Throughout the 1920s and 1930s, baseball would continue to establish systems that would become traditions in the sport. Major league teams would start investing in minor league teams, helping to develop the first farm system, where players would play for minor league teams in hopes that they would develop their skills and be called up to play for the major league teams. New Negro leagues, the Negro National League and the Negro American League, would form. Baseball established the National Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York. Little League Baseball, a children's baseball league, would be established. College baseball would become formalized under the National Collegiate Athletic Association, or NCAA. Baseball became immensely popular. The 1940s saw several changes as well. Due to World War II, several prominent players were recruited to fight in the war, often becoming national heroes in the process. A new professional league with female players was established to help keep the game popular during the war. After the war, in 1947, the College World Series would start under the NCAA. Also in 1947, the first African-American player, Jackie Robinson, would join the Brooklyn Dodgers, a National League team, breaking the long-standing color barrier. That same year, Larry Doby would play for the Cleveland Indians in the American League. Latin American players would also start to play in Major League Baseball in larger numbers. Integration happened slowly, though, taking over a decade before every team would have an African American player. The Negro American League, the final Negro League, would not be disbanded until 1962. In 1953, baseball players organized into a union, the Major League Baseball Players Association, or MLBPA. However, the MLBPA was seen as largely ineffective when it started. It would take until 1975, after a significant players' strike and a lawsuit by a player, before baseball players were given more control over contracts and the free agency system was established. Baseball would finally stretch west of St. Louis in 1958, when two teams moved from New York to California. In 1961 and 62, the first major league expansion happened, with four new teams being added for a total of 20 teams. Major League Baseball established their first draft in 1965, which allowed the teams to choose players, typically from high school or college, to sign to a contract. Major League Baseball would continue to grow and expand through the 60s, 70s, and 80s. Though this was done mostly in America, two Canadian baseball teams would also be established in the league. Outside of the United States and Canada, baseball would find an audience. In Latin America, particularly in Cuba and the Dominican Republic, baseball would become popular early. Cuba established its first formal baseball league in 1878, and the Dominican Republic would hold its first nationwide tournament in 1912. Other leagues would form in Mexico, Puerto Rico, and Venezuela as well. Since the early 1970s, the Latin American leagues would hold an annual Caribbean series, with the champions from the Dominican Republic, Mexico, Puerto Rico, and Venezuela holding a tournament for the best team. In Asia, Japan would establish itself as a strong baseball nation early as well. The Japanese major leagues, named Nippon Professional Baseball, or NPB, would be established in 1936 and would form its own leagues, the Pacific League and Central League, in 1949. The Japanese league would also have its own minor league system and players' union. Of the non-American leagues, the NPB is often seen as the most formal. Baseball would also establish itself in Europe, particularly in the Netherlands, which founded its first league in 1922. Australia would also get their own league in 1934, and South Korea would get its own league in 1982. Because of the international appeal of the sport, an International Baseball Federation, or IBAF, was founded in 1938. Its goal was to have an amateur World Series, a competition every 1 to 4 years between the world's best amateur players. These competitions would typically be dominated by Latin American teams. Major League Baseball teams will often sign the players that play in these international leagues, paying the players more money than they would make in their home leagues. As a result, Major League Baseball is often seen as the premier league worldwide for baseball. Players from those international leagues are not chosen through the draft, but have negotiations done privately between the team and the player or the player's agent. That is the history of baseball through 1985. The sport is dominated by Major League Baseball in the United States and Canada. Latin American and East Asian leagues exist and are popular in their respective countries, but the MLB is often seen as the most prestigious league. Keep in mind that by 1985, there is over a century's worth of history in the game, so there are a multitude of teams, organizations, and individuals worthy of attention that we do not have time to cover today. For now, let's briefly go over how baseball is played. We will focus on the rules of Major League Baseball. Baseball is a team sport, with each team having 9 active players at a time. The teams will take turns playing on offense and defense. A baseball game consists of innings, with each inning being a turn for the players to play both offense and defense. The visiting team will be on offense first, while the home team is on defense. This is known as the top of the inning. The home team will be on offense second, while the visiting team is on defense. This is known as the bottom of the inning. Though there are several exceptions, a baseball game will consist normally of 9 innings. The overall goal of the game is for the teams to score points, known as runs. Whichever team has more runs at the end of 9 innings will be the winner. Scoring runs is done by having players on the offensive team touch all 4 bases in a square. This square is known as the baseball diamond, or diamond. Each base is named, starting with home plate at the bottom of the diamond, then proceeding counterclockwise to first base, second base, and third base. A player must touch the bases in order, first, second, third, then home, in order to score a run. The defensive team will try to prevent the players from running the bases and will attempt to cause an out. When three outs are recorded, the teams will switch sides. The defensive team will be the one on the field. They can be identified by the leather gloves or mitts they wear on their non-throwing hand. There will be a defender known as the pitcher who will stand on a raised mound of dirt near the center of the diamond, known as the pitcher's mound. There is a piece of rubber on the pitcher's mound where the pitcher must stand at the start of a play. There will also be a defender known as the catcher that wears special protective equipment behind home plate in a white rectangle that's known as the catcher's box. The offensive team will typically have most players off the field, in a holding area known as the dugout. They will send one player to home plate at a time, known as the batter. The batter will carry a custom-made solid piece of wood, known as a bat. For protection, the batter will typically be wearing a solid helmet, known as a batting helmet. The offense will also have two coaches on the field, in coaches' boxes near first and third base. The main piece of equipment is the baseball itself. The ball is about the size of an adult fist. It has a rubber or cork center, then is wound in yarn, covered in white cowhide, then held together with red stitching. The stitching is done in a very specific way so that all baseballs should function the same when gripped and when in the air. Baseball starts as a battle between the pitcher and the batter. The pitcher will stand on the pitcher's mound, then throw the ball or pitch to home plate. The batter will be standing to one side of home plate in a white rectangle known as the batter's box. There are two batter's boxes, one on each side, that players can choose to bat from. Their goal is to hit the thrown ball with the bat into fair territory. Fair territory spreads out in a 90-degree angle from home plate, with the pitcher's mound in the center. If the batter hits the ball into fair territory, the batter must run to first base, which is on the batter's right side. The defensive players, who are positioned throughout the field, have the job of retrieving the ball and bringing it back to the diamond before the batter is able to run around the bases. When the batter starts running, he is often referred to as a runner. If possible, the defensive players will attempt to grab the ball and throw it to first base before the runner can make it there. If a defender has possession of the ball and touches first base before the runner touches first base, the runner will be out. If the runner touches first base before a defender with the ball does, the runner will be safe. This type of situation is often referred to as a force out. The offensive player is forced to run there, so the ball just has to beat the runner to the base to get the runner out. Once the runner reaches first base, he does not have to run further if he does not want to. If the runner chooses to run to second base, for instance, the force is no longer in effect. At that point, a defensive player with possession of the ball will need to touch or tag the runner while the runner is not touching a base in order to get an out. While the runner is touching a base, they are considered safe and cannot be tagged out. Once an offensive player has either been called out or has settled on a base, the next batter will come to the plate for the offense and everything starts over again. Baseball, as we mentioned, is often seen as a battle between the pitcher and the batter. When throwing the ball, the pitcher will attempt to make sure that the batter either does not hit the ball at all or hits the ball where the defenders can easily get to it. To do this, the pitcher will put certain spins on the ball that will move the ball in certain ways, making it difficult to hit. Typically, this is done with the pitcher having certain grips on the seams of the ball or throwing the ball certain ways. Pitchers will have multiple types of grips and movements, known as pitches, they can throw to keep the batter off balance. To keep things fair, the pitcher needs to throw the ball in a certain area near the batter, known as the strike zone. The strike zone is a conceptual area above home plate. It changes for each batter, stretching from the middle point between the batter's shoulders and belt and the bottom of the batter's knees. To judge whether a pitch was in the strike zone, there will be an official, known as an umpire, positioned behind the catcher. This umpire will call pitches inside the strike zone a strike and pitches outside the strike zone a ball. If the batter swings at the pitch is a strike, regardless of whether it went into the strike zone or not, and the umpire's call is not needed. These ball and strike calls will often change depending on the umpire and are often controversial. During a batter's turn at the plate, known as a plate appearance or sometimes an at-bat, there is for the most part a limited number of pitches the batter will see. If there are four pitches judged to be balls, the player is awarded first base. This is known as a walk or a base on balls. The batter will also be awarded first base if the pitch hits the batter, as long as the batter did not swing at the pitch that hit them. If the batter receives three strikes, the batter is out. This is known as a strikeout, sometimes called a K. If the batter hits the pitch with the bat and the ball does not go into fair territory, the ball is considered foul. Foul territory would be anywhere not within the 90-degree angle stretching out from home plate. A foul ball is considered out of play and is typically considered dead after the ball lands in foul territory. If the batter hits a foul ball, the batter will receive a strike. However, a foul ball cannot cause a strikeout, so if the batter already has two strikes, a foul ball will not count as the third strike. During a plate appearance, there will be two numbers that often appear on the screen. This is the count. This count will give the number of balls, followed by the number of strikes. The format of this is the number of balls, then a dash, then the number of strikes. So a count of 1-2 would mean that there is currently one ball and two strikes, and is read as 1-2. The next pitch in this count is referred to as the 1-2 pitch. When there is a count of 1-1 or 2-2, this is referred to as an even count. A count of 3-2 is referred to as a full count. The count will often change the strategies of both the pitchers and the batters, with batters typically being more patient when there are a lot of balls in the count, and pitchers being more aggressive when there are more strikes in the count. As mentioned before, when a batter hits the ball into fair territory, the batter must start running the bases. If the ball beats the batter to first base, the batter will be out. Another way to get an out is for a defender to catch the ball in the air before the ball touches the ground. A ball hit in the air is known as a fly ball, and a ball that is caught in the air is known as a fly out. If that is done, it does not matter whether the ball is caught in fair or foul territory, the batter will be out, though a ball caught in foul territory is known as a foul out. If the ball is caught in the air, it does not matter how far along the bases the batter has run, the batter is out. When a runner is on base, the rules start getting more complicated. A runner is forced to run on a ball put in play if there is no room behind the runner to add the batter. Only one player can be on a base at a time. So if a runner is on first base and the batter puts the ball in play, the runner on first base is forced to go to second base. In that case, a force out at second base is possible. As the defense, this situation will often lead to two outs in a single play, known as a double play. Typically, a ball will be hit on the ground, known as a ground ball. That ball will be fielded by a player, then thrown to second base, where another defender will catch it while their foot is on second base. This defender will then throw the ball to first base to another defender before the batter reaches first. This is known as grounding into a double play, and is quite common at the professional level. On the other hand, if a runner is on second base and there is no runner at first base when a ball is put in play, the runner on second base is not forced to run to third. Since the batter has an open base at first to run to, the runner at second can stay at second if they choose. A runner on base should stay near the base they have reached in case the defense tries to tag them with the ball. A runner on base is considered in play unless a ball is declared dead or a timeout is called. Runners will take a few steps towards the next base while on base. This is known as taking a lead. Technically speaking, a runner can attempt to run to the next base at any time. However, the best time to do this would be during a pitch. The pitcher, once a movement is started, must complete the pitch to home. The catcher can then catch the pitch, then throw the ball to other defenders where the runner is going in an attempt to get them out. This timing gives the runner the best chance to get to the next base. This is known as stealing a base. Should the defender at the new base catch the ball, then tag the runner before the runner can make it to the new base, the runner will be out. This is known as being caught stealing. A pitcher may try to throw the ball to the defender near the runner to see if they can tag the runner out while the runner is not on the base. This is known as a pickoff attempt. However, a pitcher is not allowed to try to trick the runner while the runner is on base. So, once a pitcher starts a movement towards home plate, the pitch must be completed. Any movement from the pitcher towards home plate that does not result in a pitch is considered a balk. If the umpire calls a balk, all runners on base are awarded the next base. Often, balks are called for even the smallest movements, and balk calls are typically controversial. While runners should typically be ready to make it back to a base at any point, there is one exception. For the safety of the players, batters that run to first do not need to stop at first base. They are allowed to run through first base, then turn right out of play without being liable to being tagged out. If the runner turns left after touching first base, though, that is considered an attempt to run for second base, and the runner may be tagged out. On second and third base, though, the player must stop on the base or be liable to being tagged out. This results in players sliding or diving to reach the base to make sure they stop and do not slide off the base. While runners are on base, a ball that is caught in the air forces the runners to go back to their base. So if a batter hits a fly ball to a defender, runners will often stay back on the base waiting for the ball to be caught. This is known as tagging up. Once the ball is caught, runners may attempt to run to the next base if they choose. This most often happens when a player is on third base and the batter hits the fly ball a long way, giving the runner a good chance to make it to home plate before the ball gets to home. If the player scores a run by tagging up on a fly ball, the play is known as a sacrifice fly. However, once the third out is recorded, all play afterwards does not count, so players will not do this if there are already two outs. While a team is on defense, the defensive players will be strategically positioned on the field to try to cover the most territory and to make it likely to get outs. Let's go over the defensive positions that are typical for a baseball team while going over the field of play itself. On the pitcher's mound near the center of the diamond will be the pitcher. The rubber on the pitcher's mound is positioned 60 feet and 6 inches, roughly 18.44 meters, from home plate. Because being a pitcher is considered very difficult, pitching will often be the only thing that pitchers do. Typically, pitchers will not pitch the full 9 innings, nor will they pitch every game, in order to try to save their arm from overuse. As a result, there are starting pitchers, who typically pitch the first half of the game or so before they are removed. Once a player is removed from the game in baseball, they are not allowed back into the game. Starting pitchers will be replaced by relief pitchers, who typically enter the game in the second half of the game and can pitch to as little as one batter to as many innings as needed, though one inning is most typical. These pitchers are often seen as specialists and may have special names for their role on the team, such as a closer, who typically pitches the ninth inning, or a setup man, who typically pitches the eighth inning. Relief pitchers and the area where they warm up are both known as the bullpen. Behind home plate will be the catcher. The catcher plays a dangerous position, since pitches and foul balls can and often do hit the catcher. To help, they are covered in protective gear, though injuries among catchers are still common. The catcher typically squats and will use hand signs to communicate to the pitcher what pitch should be thrown. Catchers will typically be among the toughest players on the team, though they are typically also among the slowest, as catching is difficult on players' knees. Near first base will be the first baseman. First base itself will be positioned 45 degrees to the right of home plate at 90 feet, roughly 27.4 meters. The first baseman will position himself in fair territory a few steps away from first base, trying to cover more fair territory while remaining close to the base. First basemen must be good at catching the ball in their glove, typically will be good at stretching their legs in order to catch the ball better, will often be left-handed since that allows them to see the field better from their position, and will often be among the slower players on the team. Between first base and second base will be the second baseman. Second base will be at the top of the diamond, another 90 feet diagonally from first base. The second baseman will typically play closer to second base than first base. The second baseman must be skilled with their glove, be able to field ground balls well, and have quick hands to turn double plays. Typically, a second baseman will be a smaller player on the team with one of the weaker arms. Closer to third base will be the third baseman. Third base itself will be 90 feet away from both home and second base. Much like the first baseman, the third baseman will typically play a few steps away from third base. The third baseman must have quick reactions since batted balls will often come to him very quickly. He must also be able to field ground balls well and must have a strong throwing arm to throw to first quickly. Between second base and third base will be the shortstop. The shortstop will typically play closer to second base than third base. The shortstop is often one of the best defenders on the field. Skilled with their glove, able to field ground balls well, have quick hands to turn double plays, and have a more powerful arm to throw the ball to first base quickly. The pitcher, catcher, first baseman, second baseman, shortstop, and third baseman play in the infield. They will typically play on the dirt near the bases. They are typically the players responsible for ground balls and will attempt to keep runners from running around the bases. Beyond the infield, on the grass, will be the outfield with the outfielders. To the batter's left in the outfield will be the left fielder. The left fielder's main job is to catch fly balls or to get batted balls that hit the ground into the infield as quickly as possible. The left fielder is often where teams put their worst defender, though this is not always the case. It is recommended for a good left fielder to be relatively quick and to have a strong arm. Behind the pitcher's mound and second base is the center fielder. The center fielder is also often seen as the team's best defender. The center fielder will have a lot of ground to cover, so must be quick. They will also typically have a strong arm to be able to throw the ball back into the infield, but catching fly balls is often a center fielder's priority. To the batter's right in the outfield will be the right fielder. Much like any outfielder, the right fielder's job is to catch fly balls or to throw batted balls back into the infield. In particular, though, the right fielder will typically have among the strongest arms on the team. The right fielder should be able to throw the ball from right field to third base to try to get a runner tagging up from second out at third. Behind the outfielders will be either a fence or a wall. This marks the end of what is in play, so outfielders will often try to position themselves away from the wall, but still a considerable ways back from the infield dirt. There are no league standards for where the wall is positioned or how high it is. Each field in each stadium will have a custom wall in the outfield with distances from home plate ranging typically between 300 and 450 feet, roughly 91 to 137 meters. A batter's goal is often to hit the ball where the defenders are not. This can be done in several ways, and the results of the hit will determine the name of the play. If a batter is able to hit the ball and it lands in fair territory, and the runner makes it safely to first base, this is known as a single. If the batter is able to make it to second base, this is known as a double. This happens most often by hitting the ball past the outfielders. Rarely, a batter is able to run all the way to third base. This is known as a triple. It is seen as one of the most difficult hits to get, and typically only the fastest players on the team will be able to pull it off. Typically when they do, though, the ball is hit past the right fielder, which gives them the best chance of making it to third. If a batter is able to hit the ball in fair territory over the wall in the outfield, that is considered a home run. Home runs are the best hit that a player can do. The batter and all runners on base will be able to run around the bases, with each player scoring a run for their team. Should all three bases have runners on them at the time, known as having the bases loaded, the home run is called a grand slam, which scores four runs. Rarely, a batter will hit a ball, then be able to run around all the bases before the ball gets back home. This typically happens as a result of a misplay by an outfielder. This is known as an inside-the-park home run. If a batter hits the ball and it lands in fair territory, then bounces over the wall in the outfield, this is known as a ground rule double. The batter and all runners are allowed to move forward two bases and two bases only. This same rule typically applies if a fan in the crowd interferes with a fair ball, though this also typically results in the fan being escorted out of the stadium. Batters may also decide to carefully place the ball in the infield in an attempt to outrun the defense. Known as bunting, the player will typically hold the bat out horizontally over the plate, hoping to lightly tap the pitch and place it where defenders will have a hard time reaching it. Occasionally, a bunt will be called in an attempt to move the runners on base forward. This is known as a sacrifice bunt. Bunting can be risky, however, since if a batter already has two strikes, a bunt that goes foul will be considered a third strike and the batter will strike out. The order of the batters is determined before the game starts. The coach or manager will fill out what is known as the batting order or lineup. This will determine the order that his players will take their plate appearances throughout the entire game and must be done in order with the order continuing where it left off between innings. While a player is having their plate appearance, they are said to be at bat. The next player in the lineup is said to be on deck and is often found in the on-deck circle. The player after that in the lineup is said to be in the hole and remains in the dugout. There are a multitude of strategies for setting a lineup. Every manager has their own set of strategies that they like and that they use depending on the situation. Most typically, the team's best batters will be in the top half of the lineup, with the faster players batting immediately before the more powerful batters. Of particular note is the last spot in the lineup. The ninth hitter is typically the weakest batter on the team. In the National League and Major League Baseball, the weakest batter is almost always the pitcher. The pitcher often focuses so much on pitching that they are not good batters, so the worst batter will often be the pitcher. However, in the American League, a rule was instituted in 1973 for what is known as the designated hitter. The designated hitter allowed American League teams to substitute one of their defenders for a player who only plays offense. This was designed to make the game more exciting, and American League teams almost always use the designated hitter to replace their pitcher in the lineup. The designated hitter can be placed anywhere in the lineup and is often among the team's best hitters. While on offense, a player can be replaced in the lineup by a replacement player, or bench player. If the player is batting, this is known as a pinch hitter. If the player is running, this is known as a pinch runner. Once a player is substituted for, they cannot re-enter the game, so this is typically done toward the end of the game, depending on the situation. Perhaps more than any other sport, baseball relies on statistics and statistical analysis to judge the game. This goes back to near the beginning of the game, when cricket statistics were borrowed to explain how baseball works. By 1985, there are hundreds of stats to describe what happens in baseball. While we will not go over them at this time, it is important to know that it will be difficult to talk about baseball without talking about statistics. Baseball is played in a long season, one of the longest in sports. In 1985, the teams played 162 games between early April and early October. The MLB has 26 teams playing across the United States and Canada. These teams are still separated into the National League and the American League. Each league has two divisions, the East and the West Division, though teams in these divisions will occasionally not be in that geographical area. At the end of the season, the best team in each division will play each other in a league championship series, which is a best of seven series. This is known as the pennant. The winner of each league will then play in the World Series, which is also a best of seven series. The best players from each league will play in an all-star game in the middle of the season, each representing the American or National League. That is roughly how baseball works, what the positions are for the game, and how the game is played. Keep in mind that baseball has over a century's worth of rule changes, nicknames, strategies, and analysis that can be confusing if you're not used to them, but this hopefully provides a basic understanding of the game. Just like any other sport, baseball has had its controversies over the years. The institutions behind baseball have either been guilty of or accused of racism, exploitation, and of having a monopoly. Players and teams have been accused of cheating on the field over the years. Of course, with 100 years of history, players over the years have been convicted of several crimes, including sexual crimes, violent crimes, substance abuse, and murder. While it could be argued that the percentage of players convicted of crimes is low compared to other sports, the crimes do still exist. It is important to remember that players have full lives off the field and can live flawed lives. In fact, in 1985 itself, baseball was in the middle of a scandal. Several players were found by a grand jury to be abusing illegal drugs, particularly cocaine, amphetamines, and marijuana. Known as the Pittsburgh Drug Trials, due to the focus being on several players of the Pittsburgh Pirates, the efforts to investigate how long drugs were used by players and the efforts to clean up the game began almost immediately. In the history of video games, baseball has appeared in the background almost since the beginning. While we have not specifically talked about or played any baseball games to this point, baseball video games have always been there. Baseball video games have appeared on mainframe computers, on home computers, in arcades, and on consoles. Baseball games have in fact appeared on every major console that we have talked about to this point. However, none of these video games were particularly successful or impactful. However, that changes in 1985. That will do it for the story of baseball for now. My name is Ballerscuba. This has been Video Games Over Time. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in our next video when we take the mound.